development of contextual state curriculum in school and teacher education. So here we will be talking about three confined things, that the development of a contextual state curriculum framework for school and a teacher education, and teacher education for both elementary and secondary level. Okay, with inbuilt criteria of recurrent evaluation of changing curriculum context. So that is the main point of discussion, the inbuilt criteria for recurrent evaluation of changing curricular context. So first thing is that within that, I think I should discuss, or you must be knowing, I will just see what is the situation, that what is a curriculum and what is the curriculum framework, because it talks about the curriculum framework. And there is a, another thing which should be known, that teacher education elementary and secondary level. See, when we talk about the curriculum framework, it is a policy level document which says that the curriculum should be focused on achieving what outcomes. So curriculum framework is a policy level document which gives a broad vision of education. Like then, when we talk about the curriculum framework at a school level, the recent curriculum framework that we have now is the National Curriculum Framework 2005. The new curriculum framework in the light of NEP 2020 is also in the process of development, and it will come, I think, by next year or next to next year, it will come. So curriculum framework is a policy level document. And when you will see the NCF 2005, you will find the broad vision of education and the different domain of education is emphasized there. That what should be the aim and objective of a mathematics education? What should be the aim and objective of a social science education, science education, art and culture, even the what should be the mission and a vision of a assessment. So this curriculum framework provides a mission and a vision. What should be the objective of education? For what purpose we should organize education? Because education is an organized activity. It is not an unorganized, it is an organized activity. So if the activity is organized, then we must know that what will be the mission and a vision of the activity. So curriculum frameworks provides a broad vision of the education. And based upon the broad vision, because broad vision will not be implemented. In order to implement it, we need a modality. For sake of example, when we talk about the curriculum framework, National Curriculum Framework 2005, it says that the teaching learning process, educational process at a school level will be child-centric. Teacher will be the facilitator in the educational process, and the student will be the active agent in the learning process. The assessment should be holistic in nature, and it should be focused on development of a higher order processing skills. So I was saying that in order to implement the mission and a vision which is emphasized in the curriculum framework, we need a modality. So this curriculum provides a modality that how we can make a child-centric, how we can make a assessment and evaluation holistic, isn't it? Then we comes to the syllabus. Syllabus enlists the content by which we can achieve the objectives enlisted in the curriculum and fulfill the mission and vision of a curriculum framework. Like that, one of the objective is that to make teaching learning process enjoyable with less burden, to develop the creative and a critical thinking. So then what should be the content in the syllabus? How we will develop? Content should be there. What kind of a subject we should teach? If we are talking about the holistic development of a child, so the how the holistic development will be assessed? What kind of a content will be there for a holistic development? That is the syllabus. So syllabus will enlist the objectives, the content, mode of transaction, and assessment criteria, assessment modality. When you will see, even I have this syllabus, current syllabus, curriculum assessment, you will find that in the first, they have written objectives. Through this content, what kind of objective they want to achieve. Then there is a detailed content, and then there is a assessment modality. Some assessment modality here, it is written as a seasonal work, and the detailed assessment modality is written in the rule and regulation part when you will see the whole syllabus. So all those things comes in the syllabus. Now the point is that how we can make a contextual curriculum, a state curriculum, we will come to later on, because it is nothing but it is a contextualizing those things with the state need, and so that we will discuss later on. So how we can develop a curriculum framework in high school education and in the teacher education which have a inbuilt criteria for a recurrent evaluation of changing curricular context. Before that, one more thing I will like to link here, that why it is necessary to link the curriculum framework of a school education and a teacher education program. Because we know that both are not independent, both are related with each other. The kind of innovations we want to see in the school education, that will be implemented by the teacher. And a teacher must be empowered to have those kind of innovation. And the quality of a teacher education on the other side will directly affect the process of schooling. The kind of a training they have get, the kind of a teacher education they have got, the kind of input we have given during the teacher preparation program, whether it will be the in-service or a pre-service. These will have a direct effect on the schooling process. And the kind of a change we want to see in the schooling process, that must be rooted with the teacher education program. So it have a kind of a relationship between both two things. The change we want to see in the school, that must be rooted through the teacher education, and the kind of teacher education that we will provide, the quality of a teacher education, that will directly affect the schooling process. So both are interrelated with each other. And that's why when we think of developing a curriculum framework, both should be considered simultaneously. They cannot be developed in a fragment manner. Like that, I will develop separately the school curriculum and I will develop separately the teacher education curriculum and the curriculum framework. And when both will be not aligned with each other, then whatever we will think, whatever we will visualize, that will be never achieved. because they are not aligned, and the process of schooling and the process of teacher development are interrelated with each other. So that's why it must be seen together, whether it is a development of a curriculum and a curriculum framework for a school education and a teacher education, or it is a matter of evaluation of a school curriculum and a curriculum for teacher education. Both should be done simultaneously by keeping a broad vision and a mission in mind. Then the next thing comes, that why there is a necessity of contextualizing with the state. For that, we have to understand how the educational program and a schooling program goes. We know that the schooling and the school education is a structured effort, wherein we try to imbibe the quality and we try to develop the competency and a school as per the need, as per the broader priority of the state. And the development of these need, competencies and a skill is contextualized in matter. What is the priority? Suppose that when we talk about the country like India, then one of the value that must be developed by the schooling process is the democratic value. Because the India is a democratic country, the value of respecting all religion, all people same. Because the constitution of India does not discriminate people on the basis of caste, class, religion, religion, gender, sex. We don't discriminate. So these values should be imbibed when the education is coming. But the process of imbibing is influenced by the cultural practices, the local norms, the local life, students' day-to-day life. And that's why the matter of contextualizing as per the state comes. And that's why the education has been kept in a concurrent list. Earlier, it was not in the concurrent list, when you will see. And the ministry, surprisingly, Ministry of Education was also not known as a Ministry of Education. It was earlier Ministry of Education, then it has been renamed as a Ministry of Human Resource and Development, then it is again renamed as a Ministry of Education. And I am talking the era when the Ministry of Education was Ministry of Education earlier. That time education was not in the concurrent list. That time it was in the central list, not in the state list. It was in the central list. And the central government was deciding the policy over the education. Then it was felt that the need and necessity of a different state are a different context, is a different. So the one policy governed, decided at a central level will not work for all the students, all the children in the country. And that's why it is brought out in the concurrent list, so that the state will also make a policy. They will also have a policy level decision as per the need and necessity of the state. And central can also make a regulation. Like that, when you will see the Right to Education Act, it was notified by the central government. It is enacted by the Parliament of India. But after that, in order to implement that, because the context of a state is a different, the every state of the country was asked to notify rule as per the act of a central government in order to implement that. Like that, you can also think the kind of content which we include in a syllabus at a central level. That may not be implemented in toto in the state. Because in the state, there is some context. One example I will give. Suppose that one example I will give from the school education also, and one example from the teacher education also. Suppose that when we talk about the teacher education in Orisha. So in the teacher education, in the philosophy paper, you will see that educational philosophy of a different philosophers we are supposed to study. But in the state of Orissa, there are some philosophers who have significantly contributed in the field of education that must be taught when we are teaching in state government. And that's why when you will find that Gopabandhu Das has been included. However, in our curriculum, it is not there, surprisingly. But when you will see the RI curriculum, the RI curriculum for B.Ed. Is different from the RI curriculum of Ajmer and RI curriculum Bhuneswar and Bhopal and Mysore, even the north, because the local demand is taken care there. When here you will also see the policy perspective, you will find that in the SSA, in the universalization of elementary education, secondary education, the state policy is emphasized, because we must understand what kind of a state policy is there. But when you will see the other state curriculum, their priority, their policy is emphasized. Their culture is seen. Even when we talk about the school curriculum, suppose that the way we are teaching and the content that we are having in school, and suppose that in the social science or even in the mathematics, even in the science, the main content will be same, but the way of explanation, way of exemplification will be contextual to the state, so that the student of that state can easily understand. And that's why it is required that the curriculum and a curriculum framework that we are having must be contextualized with the need and necessity of the state. Isn't it? Because the schooling process is not a way which will, where the universal structure will work everywhere. Education is a social process, we all know. The law Vygotsky has said well before. So the social context and the norms should come in between. Then the schooling will be more meaningful. And like that, I always used to say that when you will teach A for Apple in the metropolitan city, even in the city like Bhuneswar, people may understand, student may understand, but when you will teach A for Apple in the tribal area, they will never understand. They can remember, they can memorize A-double-P-L-E, Apple, and this is the color, shape and size of Apple. They can memorize, but they will never understand. That's why the contextualization comes, and that's why the contextualization of a curriculum and the curriculum for the school and the curriculum for a teacher education also comes. We must know the culture, and that's why Gopabandhu is taught in the Orissa. But when you will go to the teacher curriculum, teacher preparation curriculum in the Bihar and Jharkhand, you will not find the Gopabandhu. And very frankly saying, when I came to Orissa, then I came to know that the Gopabandhu has worked so much for the state of Orissa, for uplifting the educational situation in the Orissa. So that is the modality of, that is the cause of, that is the need of contextualizing to the state perspective. Now, the main point of our discussion is that how we can inbuilt criteria for a recurrent assessment, recurrent evaluation of the curriculum, curriculum framework as per the changing curricular context. The one thing, that one action that can be done, which should be an inbuilt feature of a curriculum and curriculum framework, that evaluating and modifying the curriculum and a curriculum framework at a regular interval. Because the need in education is always changing. It is a dynamic process. We know education is a dynamic process. Even the need and necessity of an individual also changes. Like that, when you, I will talk about the teacher education program. Earlier, the ICT was not the major component in the teacher education program. Even it was absent in some places. Then, with the evolution of educational technology, ICT, and by recognizing its potential for the teaching learning purpose, ICT is included. But it was also not having a significant, you can say that, weightage in the teacher education program. But with the coming of this pandemic situation throughout the world, the educators and the person working in the area of education have recognized that developing competency of handling tools of ICT, taking online classes, managing blended learning, having online assessment should be developed. And that's why now the UGC even saying that 25% of a curriculum will be conducted, will be held in a blended mode. Not only for this pandemic situation. After some time, this situation will be over and we have a hope that the situation will improve. But even the UGC says that even after that, the 25% of a curriculum will be completed in the blended mode, blended learning, isn't it? Because the time is that. So a curriculum and a curriculum framework must have an inbuilt mechanism of reviewing, evaluating and modifying at a regular interval. Ideally, as per the norm, it must be done at an interval of 3 years, every 3 years. It must be done. Ideally. In some part of a country, in some university I have seen, they used to modify the syllabus before beginning of each academic year. I have seen there are a lot of universities in the country, in India, I am not talking about the foreign universities. In India, there are universities who used to modify their syllabus content at the end of every academic year, commencement of every academic year. So this would be the one of the modality for recurrent evaluation and changing of curricular context. The next thing that can be done is that making a provision of student feedback. Because we know that in the process of assessment and evaluation of a curriculum and a redesigning and modifying of a curriculum, students are not involved. Their feedback, I'm not saying that a student must be asked that what you want to learn. No. The feedback of a student must be taken care of. Like that when you will pass this course. Then what was your overall experience in doing this course? In the content part, in the transaction modality, in the assessment modality. What should be, what was your expectation? What kind of a competency, what kind of a skill you thought of developing? And what level of your expectation is satisfied? And what should be done in order to satisfy your expectation? So that type of exercise must be done, and that type of a provision must be there in a curriculum. So this will be one of the very important thing when we think of providing a criteria inbuilt mechanism in assessment and evaluation of a curriculum. Then another thing is that most of the time the assessment and evaluation is done by some of the teachers, some of the officials who are working in the field of education, and leaving the feedback of teachers who are teaching in the class. Because you think, whatever the policy we will make, whatever the framework that we will make, who will implement those things? Obviously, it will be implemented by the teacher in the classroom. Big professors sitting in the AC room, they are not coming in the class. So, the kind of difficulty faced by the teacher in the class. I was talking about that since the teacher is involved in implementing the curriculum and transacting the curriculum, they are teaching, so they are better known to the problem faced. They are better known to the what kind of a need and necessity is there. So their feedback must be taken when we think of this evaluation of curriculum and a curriculum framework. And that's why you will find that when this new education policy was designed, this National Education Policy 2020, the feedback from all the stakeholders have been collected, scrutinized, and appropriate feedback and recommendation is included in the National Education Policy. So many deliberation and a consultation meeting was conducted before developing this education policy, new National Education Policy 2020. So that should be also the inbuilt mechanism. Then another inbuilt mechanism of a curriculum and a curriculum framework is that provision of including the local need and necessity and a context in the development of curriculum and curriculum framework. Like that, when we are teaching and when we are organizing a school in a tribal area, then development of a competency and a skill related to that area must be emphasized. When we are organizing schooling in the urban area, so the need and necessity and a skill and a competency required for the urban area must be developed. So that should be a part of a curriculum.